pimping hoes, ride clean, smoking dope. I ain't bitch, pussy soaking, and she give me throat. Whipping with no kind, it's the mind with them diamond rings. Strapped up with that line for a line to blow up their brain. Using like a mech, whether we pulling a pack of the maze. Bitches, they want me to save them, nah. Fuck them and put them in labor, nah. Creeping with one in the chamber, smoke a sucker like crack. Cryptomaniac, get this hoe down to the track.
I got my family than the 504. At 504,
yeah.
Back at home, my life's a bore. Try not to snore.
Let me put a scenario in your head. You want to out-alpha everybody. 4,000 RPM, aggressive with the throttle. All stretched out. The pipes are deafening, okay? Everybody's running for cover. It's, you win. Every other bike, game over. And I'm just scratching the surface. I did a ton of work on this thing in the last 2-3 months, right? A lot of big pieces, some small pieces, but mostly like big pieces to get the foundation of the bike back. So originally I was headed in the direction of just like full Cholo Road King, which was fine, but you know, it's been done and I wanted to try something a little bit different where I go in to a place where not that many people go. And that's a hybrid build between a Cholo touring bike and a bagger. Like most baggers, one of the most distinguishable features on this bike is the front wheel. So I know I've always talked shit about 26-inch wheels in the front and how they look kind of goofy, but I don't know what happened. Something one day, it just clicked. And I was like, well, it actually does look kind of good. These wheels are made by MetalSport. They're the LA Lace. And I got the 26 by 3.75 in the front. And I got the 18 by 4.25 in the rear. I called up MetalSport one day, dude was mad cool. I told him what I want, he knew exactly what to do. So the order's in, it takes a little shy of 2 months.
All right, so after 6 weeks of waiting, they're finally here.
So I opened the box, the first thing I noticed, besides how dope they look, was how lightweight they are.
And it's light.
So what led me to the design of this wheel was the fact that I planned on doing a major power upgrade. And knowing that big torque can lead to the destruction of your rear wheel, I needed to get away from spoked wheels. So I needed to find something that could also fit the bill of a Cholo, but could handle the torque of a giant motor. And these wheels truly hit all the marks. And the fact that basically nobody has them means that they're a diamond in the rough. And as much as I love spoke wheels, without the spokes, you eliminate potential problems with leaks, with tightening, with, you know, truing spokes. That is now eliminated. Now the black, it's actually not powder coat. That's anodized black. They said it's actually a truer black than powder coated black. And they say it's a hell of a lot tougher and you don't have to worry about UV. Not to hate on powder coat, because I have plenty of powder coat on this bike. The exhaust. Completely new exhaust. headers, S&S power tune duals, very interesting. They appear to be true duals, but they're not. They actually have a crossover. It's hidden, it's where the pipes meet, and it's not nearly as drastic as the Vance and Hines X pipe. This looks more of like dresser duals with that undercross. And you do get the benefits of having like a tune to one with this. It's not gonna put out the power of like a D&D Borzilla, but regain some torque through better scavenging.
That thing is so loud.
So here's where decisions for the exhaust got a little bit tricky, because commonplace for Cholos is typically a fishtail exhaust, where commonplace for baggers is usually 2-into-1 dumps out the side. But I thought as long as I could maintain a true dual look that goes out the back to soften the end of the bike, I could maintain a Cholo look. Now, Steady Custom Cycles, it's been a company I've been using for a couple years now, mostly for exhaust, and they just came out with these upswept. I had to try them. I called them on the phone. They said the upswept are actually louder than the fishtails. I wanted them a little bit shorter than my old fishtails, the fishtails I had in the 40, but I decided to get these in 37 inch. That way they would stick out a little bit, but it wouldn't be so drastic to really kind of make a separation in the bike. And we'll talk about that a little further, especially with the front wheel. Just so you know, the engine internals are still stock, for now. But at around 3,000 RPM, there's a tone change where the cams really start to come alive. You know, this is a 4-inch stroke, so it's meant to be revved higher, you know, most of the time. So 3,000 RPM, a significant change in the tone. It makes you want to rev the shit out of it because it sounds so good. Now it's 1 3/4 all the way until the very end. The last 2-3 inches, it widens up just a little bit and it will accept an exhaust tip. Now they do give you an exhaust tip. It's dope, it came in chrome. I found a company on eBay. They make custom exhaust tips, whatever size you want. They make a few different designs and they fit right in. One bolt, you're good to go. As far as the color, this is not a Steady Custom Cycles color, and this is not an S&S color. I actually brought the whole system to my powder coater and had him Cerakote it in that special 1800 degree Cerakote satin black. One of the greatest things I've ever done on this bike. Air suspension. Did American suspension. So starting with the rear, I ended up, you know, pulling the shocks off, put the new shocks back on, the new air suspension shocks. Then I started mounting the tank, which has the compressor built into the bottom of it. And then you just start doing the wiring from there. The wiring is actually very easy. Everything's plug and play. Rigging up hoses that come with it, you just cut them to length. Everything's just push connect. And when you want to disconnect, you just kind of like pull and pull it out. So the rear was done. The rear is the easy part. Now you move to the front and you gotta rip the forks out and all that. And the front end's where you can really add your own flavor to it, because you can set the height of where you want it. So if you're full air up, you can make it so that it's actually not gonna be at full ride height. It gives me about 2 inches of travel, but to me, that's enough. And when you're riding on air, when it's properly set up with the proper, you know, fork oil, it's actually a nice plush ride. You can make it really hard, but you can also make it really soft. So I did the dampening rods and messed with that, and I got exactly where I wanted. And then I got from Dirty Works those discs, basically, so that you add as many of those discs as you want until you reach that maxed out level where you still have a gap between your fender and the aux light bar. So that way it'll never bottom out, ever, because those things are there to stop it. They're like bump stops, essentially. They are bump stops. So I got that all squared away. I put the pucks in, you know, the springs that come with the front air kit, put those in, no problem.
Oh, yep, that's a big fucking metal splinter.
I ran all the lines kind of like underneath the front part of my seat down and through one of the holes in like that firewall, and they all come out nice and neat, and they go all to that controller. You know, it's like a trombone or a trumpet thing. It's kind of cool. It's very cool looking design. Now let's do a quick rundown on how this air suspension works.
What's up, girls? All right, I'm gonna run through this little spiel here. It's very easy. Adding air.
And that's pretty much it. All right, so we pulled up in the parking lot, we want to dump all the air, right? Bottom. Okay, you definitely have to hit it longer for the dump than you do for the add. It just dumps longer. The rear always dumps first than the front, I'm assuming just because of proximity.
With a 26-inch wheel, you're gonna need a front-end rake kit. There's really no way around it because your front end would just be all smushed up, your trail would be all out of whack, the bike would basically just be downright dangerous to ride, especially at any kind of like highway speed. So once again, I turned to American Suspension for the bolt-on rake kit.
Let's have a look at the raked neck. Now, once it's all set up and you get on the bike for the first time, it's gonna feel a little bit different.
I'm telling you, American Suspension products, they never fail to impress me.
Your turning radius gets worse. You know, it just makes things a little bit more difficult when you're doing like a driveway 3-point turnaround.
All right, let's go for a ride. I'm sorry, I used that stupid joke in the last video.
And to me, I really didn't care about that. What I wanted was high-speed stability.
Not even close.
Highway speed, or, you know, really anything like 40 and up.
Oh, you motherfucker.
I don't want to hit 100 on this thing eventually when I finally have enough power, only to realize that the whole bike gets shitty at 100. So the rake corrects your trail, which now the bike is unbelievably stable at highway speed, more so than it was before, and particularly now with this 26, it just rolls over everything.
Out fucking around with the cameras for too long, I forgot I had no gas. There's not a gas station within 5 miles from here, so I can't even walk. I don't want to walk. You know, to make matters worse, I hear dripping. There's a squirrel taking a dump in the tree above me.
I mean, it
was like many drips. Right. And I look up and I see like,
all my niggas so hungry, man, they just see what they kill. I like convertible Bentleys and houses deep in the hills. I might tell the whole crew come through. My squad got a roll through, come through. Tell the young high school kids.
You know, it wouldn't be Harley if a mod didn't screw something else up on the bike. And while I'm buying the pipes and a couple other things from Steady Custom Cycles, I'm taking a look at their bars. And they got very similar bars to the Cyclesmith bars that I had. No funky design, just like straight Apes. So the model of the bars is the Traditions, I'm assuming because they're a very traditional look. I got them in 1.5.
They're 1.5. I decided to try something different.
Because I ended up getting their rear crash bar in 1.5, my front crash bar is in 1.5. So I'm like, let me just have a little bit of continuity here. I got all these bars on the bike. Let me at least make them the same thickness. So I decided to try the 1.5s. which marry up perfectly with my risers, which actually neck down to 1 inch. Up top, all my controls mounted up perfectly.
But honestly, I'm getting so nasty at bars, like I did these in about an hour. Like, this is where I am. The other bars came off, I redid the wiring, got the wiring through. Now it's just buttoning it up.
Now with the 16s versus the 19s, it does offer a little bit more relief. So you're able to actually push your bars more forward for that more gangster look. And it looks even more gangster because the angle of your rake is more extreme. What you want is the pushed forward look. That is the cool look. That is what's gonna win you trophies. That's what's gonna make everybody's jaw drop when you show up, because you have an obtuse front end. That is the triangle. 1, 2, 3. In fact, this entire bike is all about obtuse triangles. Now, if you look at the very front, the absolute front,
the absolute top, and then the absolute rear. That's an obtuse triangle. So next time somebody says, yo, what kind of bike you got? You say, well, you know, it's an obtuse triangle, essentially. Fender. Made by Clockworks, it's called the Benchmark. It's a 26-inch wheel. I'm sure you guys have noticed the little flare it has at the bottom. I got it because what it does, it eliminates the need for a chin spoiler. And why would you want a chin spoiler with this kind of setup? Is because if you have a traditional looking fender on your 26 without a chin spoiler, what happens is you start to get this gap in between your front frame and your fender. And it becomes a very ugly gap very, very quickly. It almost makes it so that the bike is now two separate entities. You have like the main part of the bike, and then you just have your front wheel, as if they're so spread apart that it's not really part of each other. It almost becomes like a chopper, which went out of style 20 years ago. Now, these may seem like kind of mundane, really annoying little things to think about and probably listen to me talk about. When you add all these little things up, that's the difference between going to a show and having 30 people crowding around your bike versus the other guy who didn't do those things, whose bike is parked near the dumpster and no one gives a fuck. Bike's 20 years old, so you know some of the pieces are a little outdated looking. Some of them aren't, but some of them are. One of which I believe was the tank console. So there was a few companies that made tank consoles. Ultimately, I ended up choosing Bad Dad, which I tried for the Softail and I didn't like the fitment. This also don't like the fitment. Yeah, I want to like Bad Dad. They make a lot of really cool looking stuff. But every part I get from them, there are fit and finish issues. It's like the little things, like where your indicator lights go, the holes just cut too big. So now I need to figure out how to fill in those tiny little gaps. The speedometer doesn't like want to sit in properly. It just requires many hours of work to get this thing to look absolutely perfect. But I don't want to return it. It's already installed. I already painted it myself. I think it looks sick from like 10 feet away. You know, and by design, Cholos are not clean. They're not meant to look clean. They're not clean bikes. There's a lot going on with a Cholo. There's supposed to be a lot. That's part of its charm.
Sam, what's your take on all the new upgrades?
It's coming out sick. Like, what comes to mind is dog.
You know, I talked about themes a couple years ago, and if you really mess that up, it's just gonna look like a mess of a bike. But if you texture the bike properly, it'll look so much cooler than a clean bike that just has smooth everything. All right, so check this. Your saddlebags. Especially if you have stretched saddlebags, you have this giant wall of just flat area, nothing going on. You know, you got this one kind of arch, which, you know, it's not a bad design, but I'm thinking, how can I add texture without making it look stupid? Bag guards.
They look sick. I gotta say, they add a little bit of something. They also push the back out about an inch and a half.
It's the simplest thing. It adds, it breaks up the hard edge at the bottom. It just adds, it like softens the edge and it adds more texture, adds more flavor to the bike. The one thing that was kind of a pain to mount these is that you actually have to drill and make a hole into your fender side strips, those strips that cover your suspension from the rear. You just have to drill small holes into it in order to mount it properly, because it has to go into the rear. Other than that, it was a piece of cake. Now to go along with it, I also got the rear crash bar, which, you know, what else can I say? It looks great. It wraps around the exhaust down here. It protects your bags, and it also goes perfectly with the bag guards because it has this extra little nub here to accept the bag guards. Now, I think the build is going great. I love the way it looks. I love the way it rides. I have so much fun riding this thing. And just so you know, I mean, this isn't the final paint. It hasn't been truly finished painted yet. So it's gonna look a lot different than it does now. Other things, you know, me and my wife, we had a baby in August. So I've been very busy. I'm sure you fathers out there, you guys know how that goes. Also, do me a favor, comment on this. I really do want to know. Me and a large part of the film crew that made the beginning of this film want to make a full bike movie, full-length movie. And we just want to know what people think about that. If we were to put it out on YouTube, would you guys sit down and watch an hour and a half long, you know, movie that we made? Let me know if it's a good idea, bad idea, whatever. We want to know before we commit to this thing. But either way, films will still be coming out, and we'll see you guys soon.
This is the end, my friends. Don't you worry.